cell. The coronavirus spike protein has to undergo some crazy gymnastics in order to get the virus to fuse with the cell. So how does it do it? Let's take a look.
So I'm all about having fun, but I'm also a serious scientist. And I don't think that the two are contradictory, and so I try to give people an explanation that's understandable to them and that's fun, but I also want you to be familiar with the more scientific terms and the ways that you'll see things displayed scientifically, like in figures like this. So today I want to try to bridge the two and give you a more formal introduction to spike, or the S protein. It's this protein that juts off the surface of the SARS-CoV-2, so the coronavirus that's causing this pandemic that we're in. So it's the protein that sticks off the surface of that virus, and it allows the virus to get into the cell. So basically your virus is this like sphere of lipid, like it has this lipid membrane. So lipid is like this fatty thing. And so it has this fatty thing, and then inside that is like the viral RNA, so it's genetic blueprint, as well as a couple of like viral proteins and that sort of thing. And so it wants to get that stuff into the cell so that the cell will make more of the virus. But it has to merge into the cell. So the cell is also surrounded by its lipidy thing. And the important thing here is that, like, so lipid, think like oil. So you try to put oil and water, they don't mix. So you can have this lipid coat surrounding this watery thing. And so you have that happening in the virus, and you have that happening in the cell, where you have this liquidy part surrounded by this lipid part surrounded by all this liquidy stuff outside. And you want to get the liquidy parts together. So how you're going to do this is you need to fuse them. And there are a couple ways that this can happen. So one is that it happens at the surface. So what we call like early fusion. So it happens like at the surface. The other option is that the virus docks onto the cell. It gets sucked into this lipid, to this pouch called an endosome. And then it gets out once it's in the endosome. And so the key, which happens depends on like the cell type and which proteases it expresses. So the reason why this protease matters is a protease is a protein scissors. And it turns out that you actually have to cut the spike protein in order to get it to merge with the membrane. And because it has to go through this kind of like dramatic shape change. So basically the spike protein, it has this pre-fusion conformation, and that's the state in which it binds the protein. So it's like this pre-fusion. It binds to the ACE2 receptors on the cell, and then those gets cut by proteases. And this allows the spike protein to undergo this dramatic shape shift, where it's going to, like, part of it's going to get cut off, part of it's going to shoot out. That shootout part's going to enter into the membrane, pull back, and merge the two membranes together. So basically, how I described this the other day, and it makes sense for me, but if it doesn't make sense for you, I'm sorry. But basically, the spike protein is a homotrimer. So it has three copies of the same like chain. So a chain of amino acids. So a protein is made up of chain or chains of amino acids. So if you have a single chain, it's just like a monomer. If you have like multiple chains, it's a multimer. And so it has three chains, so it's a trimer. Those chains are all the same, so it's a homotrimer. If they were different, it would be a heterotrimer, but they're the same, so it's a homotrimer. And so you have these three chains, and what they're gonna do is these chains have these two main parts. There's this S1 part, and there's this S2 part. And so it looks kind of like broccoli on like a head of broccoli. So the head of the broccoli is your S1 part, and the stalk of the broccoli is your S2 part. The S2 parts are stuck together, and then the S1 parts are kind of like on top, like a head. But I only have two arms, but there's three. So just imagine I have a third arm, and you have something like this, where these are the S1, these are the S2. And so the S2s are hanging out in this stalk. And in the center of this S2, it's actually more like this. So I can't like flex like that, but it's kind of like that. And so basically it's folded over, and there's a part here called a fusion peptide, and that part is hydrophobic, so it likes lipid. So hydrophobic is like water fearing, but it's more just like the water doesn't like it, so the water excludes it, gangs up around it, and so it hangs out in the membrane part. So the S1 is sitting on top of these. So this is kind of like this awkward, like, state thingy, my Bob. And so if you unawkwardize it, it'll shoot out. When it shoots out, that part that likes the lipids, that was hanging out with this other parts that like the lipids, is now exposed in all this watery stuff. It doesn't like the watery stuff, so it wants to get back into lipid stuff. And remember, the cell has that lipid stuff surrounding the cell. So it's going to shoot out into the cell membrane, and then it's going to actually fold back, so it's like pew, pew, but slightly different shape. But pew, grabs on, pew, grabs back, and then pulls these membranes together. But in order to do that, you have to cleave off that head of the broccoli, the S1 part. And so you need a protease to do this. And so now this is where things get a little bit confusing, because it turns out there's like two protease cleavage sites. There's this S1-S2 site, and this, which is sometimes known as the polybasic site or the furin cleavage site, and then there's an S2 site. So the S2 site is the one that's like actually required to cut off the S1, but the S1-S2 site can kind of, if it gets like pre-cleaved, it can make it easier to cut off the S2 site. So like all coronavirus proteins have this S2 site, because that's what's needed to actually cut off the head. But then you can also have this S1-S2 site, and so that can make it easier to cut off the head, but it can also make the protein slightly less stable, so it's not like it's like slam dunk win for the virus. So sometimes, now I want to introduce you to this thing called like a domain architecture. So you might have seen this. So this, something like this. So this is showing like the a basic overview of the sequence of the protein. I mean, it's not showing this actual sequence, but like different parts of the protein. So we call different parts of the proteins domains. So sometimes we talk about like structural domains, and so those are things that will like fold independently. Like if you cut it off from the rest of the protein, it'll fold like it would normally, and it will act like it would normally. We can also talk about functional domains. So that's basically just a part of the protein that does something. And so a lot of times we'll just call something a domain because we want some way to refer to it. So it's kind of like you might have like a bedroom in your house, or you might have one of those rooms where it's kind of like one big room, but you kind of like have your living room half of it, and then like your dining room half of it, and so you call those different things. It's kind of like that for a protein. We just want to refer to these things differently, and so often we'll talk about domains that are the same in multiple different parts. So with the coronavirus, a couple of the main domains that you'll hear about are this RBD. So this is the receptor binding domain. So that's a part of the head. So it's kind of like if we go back to our broccoli stalk. So it's kind of like a finger on the head of the broccoli. So it's like something that goes up and down and up and down. So it's part of the S1 subunit, but it's not the whole S1 subunit. And so it's the part that's going to go up and down, up and down. It's going to bind the receptor. So the ACE2 receptor has to bind in order for it to be like able to be activated and cleaved and cut off and stuff. And plus it like docks it onto the protein, so that when you have that dramatic up down thing, you're actually pulling into the membrane. So what you don't want, so like one of the reasons why it's not like a slam dunk to have that furin cleavage site is that if you have like pre-fusion, like if you have it activated too early, then the protein is just gonna like shoot up and like, what the heck, like there's no membrane here to pull back into. So that's not good for the virus. So that's the RBD. So here you'll see that you have this S1, S2 site here, and this S2 site here, and this is the fusion peptide. So that's the hydrophobic part. This H1, these like heptad repeat things, so those like, this is the part that's like here. The top of here, so between this yellow and this orange, that's the part we talked about that gets stabilized by those prolines. So the prolines are going to stabilize that part. And then you also have some other parts like the transmembrane domain. So that's the part that actually goes through the viral membrane. And then you have a C-terminal domain or a cytoplasmic domain part inside of the cell. And so this is showing, so this is a cryo-EM structure. So we talked about cryo-EM yesterday, but it's this technique that we can use to get a look at what proteins look like. And so this is showing you the structure with like the three protomers. So this is showing you the homotrimer. And it has in color one of the protomers, so one of the individual chains. But remember, you have three of these. And this one has one RBD up, so one receptor binding domain up. So they can have one, two, or three up. And that's the part that's actually going to bind to ACE2. And so you can see that you often have it like colored by the domain. And so that's the case here. So you have it colored by the domain. So the receptor binding domain is in green. And you can see that yellow and that orange, those parts that are going to shoot up and into the membrane and pull it back down. So this is the type of figure that you might see when talking about